today. What's up? Welcome to my humble home, FAQ 145. What's up? You guys are amazing. Have I told you that? You know why you're amazing? Because you keep on asking incredible f***ing questions. That's what's up. That's why I have to keep on making these FAQs. And that makes me happy. Because it's a really good way for me to just, you know, respond to you guys and engage with my audience, okay? That kind of got lost with Sunday with Ola for a little bit. But it's back, baby. It's an FAQ. Okay, let's just go. Magic's Word 8. Hey Ola, I was wondering if you ever feel overwhelmed by the amount of guitars and gear you own. How much stuff you own do you use consistently? Are you ever surprised to find that you own something that you don't remember owning? Oh. This is a great question because then I can boast about how good I have it right here. I mean, look at this. Look at this rack. There's probably like 30 guitars in this rack right now. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's 8 guitars there. Back when I had my office in my apartment, you know, I had a huge issue with not knowing what I had because we had a storage room and all of that, and you know, I didn't have the room for the guitars that I owned. Now it's a little bit easier because now we have more space, but I tried to kind of keep, you know, gear level at a low because I don't want to be overwhelmed with stuff. So one of the things that I do is that, you know, for instance, Will It Chug, which is a series that happens a lot and pretty often, you know, I've done a lot of gear for Will It Chug. But the deal I have there is that whatever I put off for Will It Chug, I just give it away to my YouTube members. So that's an easy solution right there. I just, you know, give away a bunch of shit to my members. And because of that, I don't have a lot of stuff. Well, I do have a lot of stuff in there. You've seen the videos. There's a bunch of amps in there and pedals and whatnot. But yeah, it's a lot easier to keep track of what I have now when I have it all stored in there. But back when I had, you know, the storage unit, it was like every time I went there, which wasn't really that often because, you know, it's a problem when it's far away. You have to go there and, I mean, you need a reason to go there. And I go there and I'm like, huh, what the hell? I didn't remember I had this. But now I have everything up here. So every time I go in there, it's like, okay, yeah, there's... That's the distortion, that's, yeah, I remember that, and whatever, and you know, it's a lot easier. Let's just say that. It's definitely not a hurdle of being a YouTuber. To have all of these, you know, available at the tip of my fingers, it's actually very nice. Because, you know, I turn my hobby into my job. And it's great. I can recommend, just saying. Thank you. Jansen Heinlein, what are some of your favorite signature guitars you've seen other than anything released by Solar Guitars or any of the Dime signatures? Okay, that's a really good question. I have a couple, and obviously Dimebag, number one for me regarding the guitars. But I've always been a huge fan of Ibanez guitars. And with that, I mean Steve I and John Petrucci, when John Petrucci was still with Ibanez. That was a long time ago. But for me, the Steve I universe has always been, you know, an incredible signature guitar. And, you know, the Gem in general, holy shit. I mean, he basically put RG on the map, you know, with the Gems and the universes and all that. So I'm gonna bring those over here.
All right.
So this is the P4 Ibanez JPM. I had a microphone. Amateur right there. So this is the Ibanez P4 John Petrucci signature back from, when is it? Does it say? 98. I had a P2 back in the day as well, but I sold that one and then I managed to find this one a little later. And I just really like these guitars, man. There's just, you know, they have a little bit of a rounder shape to the neck than the regular Wizard necks. And I always thought they sounded incredible.
Oh, John Petrucci!
I mean, especially like the middle position right here. That's nice. Very, very Dream Theater-ish, you know? Oh, no, no. Oh, shit.
This is in my head. Yada yada yada. Don't remember the lyrics. And I'm shit at playing guitar and singing at the same time. Yeah!
So, that's the JPM2, PE4, sorry, right there. Excellent signature guitar, I love it. But obviously, the next one is the Universe Ibanez. It's just a really good guitar. I remember this guitar being the first comfortable 7-string guitar that I played. I had the RG7620 and that was a great guitar, but then I got this in my lap and I was like, holy shit, okay, it can actually be enjoyable to play 7-string. So, I mean, just look at it. This is a timeless classic right here. And obviously I got Steve's signature on there because I'm so fucking cool. I mean, how can you go wrong with something simple as this? Fucking Ibanez, man. I love this guitar. I love having this guitar. And you know what? This is probably my favorite Steve Vai guitar right here. But I must say, the new Paya jam guitar with the pink version. Oh my god. I want one. I guess that's like the only signature guitar now that I would love to own. That new pink Paya Ibanez guitar. So there you go, thank you so much for that question. Daniel Ramirez, hey Ola, how frequently do you change the strings on the guitars that you use on, the least? Greens from Costa Rica. So even though it seems that I'm playing a lot of guitar when I'm, you know, doing YouTube and all that, it's actually not a lot because, you know, in between the times where I'm making videos, I'm doing a lot of other shit, you know, editing and taking care of emails and whatnot. So I'm not actually playing that much guitar, to be honest. And you know, having, you know, being Ola Englund, you know, president of Solo Guitars, and having access to these 30 guitars in the rack, that's really 8 guitars right here. That's also something I forgot to say about the amount of guitars that I have, is that with Solar Guitars, I try to kind of switch up the guitars that we have to more current available guitars. So I don't really keep all the old ones. We basically ship them out and maybe it becomes a B stock later. But I don't keep too many of the old ones because otherwise I would just, you know, have piles and piles of guitars. So I'm trying to kind of switch it up and have current models on the rack there. But regarding the, what was it? The strings, yes. The good thing about being president of Solar Guitars is that when the strings become old, you just take another guitar. That's a shitty thing to say, but I would say I don't sweat that much. My hand sweat is not really acidic, so I don't have to change strings that often when I'm not touring. I mean, if I'm here, I rarely play guitar. If I'm on tour, you know, I have to change strings every, you know, second or third show or something like that. But that's a completely different situation right there, where I sweat more, I play for a longer stretch of time, and it's just putting a lot more stress onto the strings. Now here, it's very seldom that I change strings, actually. So, yes, thank you. HHS Guitar Geek. So I really have a question that bugs me forever. I can't tell if high output passive humbuckers and low medium output humbuckers are better for metal. I look on forums and they all seem to have different cases for being great. That's an excellent question and maybe not spoken about a lot. So here goes. High output pickups, usually connected to metal. I mean, people want high output pickups because they want more gain, they want more push. And you know, EMG pickups, for instance, they have a really high output. And it gives a little bit of a compressed signal, which is great for metal. If you plug it into a rectifier, that EMG81 sounds kick-ass without the need of a boost or anything like that. But the problem is that you're limiting yourself with high output pickups, because if you pick those high output pickups, you're stuck with that. That is the beginning of your guitar tone right there. Perhaps if you go with a medium output pickup, there's just a lot more to the dynamics of that pickup other than the high output pickup that's always kind of, it's just high output all the time. Medium and low has way more dynamics going and way more headroom, in the sense that, you know, you can just add stuff after the guitar. And I think that is a way better approach to build your metal guitar tone. You have a guitar with a medium or a low output pickup, and then you add, you know, distortion pedals or overdrives or whatever needs to be added to create your tone. But if you have that high output pickup, you're kind of stuck there in a way. You know, it sounds good, but I think you have more options going with a medium output pickup, if that makes any sense. The pickups on the guitar is where your tone starts. And, you know, I would want more leverage with that and then be able to add more and more things. With high output pickups, you're narrowing it down a little bit more. I mean, it might sound good, and that's great, that's awesome. This is just how I think and believe, okay? So, there's no rhyme or reason. Everything works in different ways and manners. Thank you. Political Ola. Arsaka Finn. Ola, ola, ola. Can you play us your most favorite riffs that you righted yourself throughout the years? Don't say that you don't have a favorite, just pick them. Raise your horns and enjoy the music. Well, that's a great question. And, I probably have a lot of favorite riffs that I can't play because I don't remember them. But I think one of the more common riffs that I still know and still play live is Time Will Not Heal. And what? Do we have sound? Do we have good sound right now? Oh, it's not plugged in, that's why. Note to self, you need to be plugged in. Yeah, but one of my favorite riffs to play at least, and you know, I like it because it has a lot of stanky groove to it, is Time Will Not Heal, which goes like this. That's a fun riff. Very, very Pantera inspired, obviously. What else? Follow Man, maybe? Almost. But yeah, that's a cool riff. I like that song. Obviously, what else? Like Lord's Resistance Army is a classic riff. That's a cool riff. I have a burp coming. Three riffs, that should be enough. Thank you. Check those out. Seb, will you buy a PS5 or an Xbox Series X? Great question. Now, I'm personally more of a PlayStation guy. And I actually pre-ordered a PS5 back this when they announced it through a store. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to get one of the first ones. I just got news of this like a week or so ago. And unfortunately, I'm not getting one this year. But my son has been selling newspapers and shit for Christmas. So I actually tried and pre-ordered the Xbox Series... Xbox Series S? Is that what it's called? The low-end model? I actually pre-ordered one of those. So he has that on pre-order for his money. And with Microsoft buying Bethesda and, you know, all of that, I think we're gonna have a better competitive generation this time. I think last generation with PS4 and Xbox, the exclusives for the PlayStation was just so much better than what's available on Xbox. So I think Microsoft buying Bethesda, I think that's good for the competition. So it's gonna be really interesting seeing how this next generation will fare. I'm into it. I'm looking forward to it, and hopefully I'll get a PS5 early next year or something like that. But, you know, I don't really have a rush. So there you go. DC Lumix. Hi Ola, perhaps a delicate question, but could you tell us the proportion of your income that comes from your various professional activities? YouTube membership, solar, music, merch sales, etc. Don't want specific figures, just percentage of total. Thank you, and keep the great work. Thank you. So, for me, the bigger portion of my income has now become solar guitars, but that shift just recently happened. Before that, it was basically equally, you know, YouTube memberships actually, and YouTube ad revenue, and solar guitars. About 50-50, I would say. But lately, solar guitars have become a little bit bigger. Say 40% solar guitars, 40% YouTube, and 20% merch, I would say. So merch has a smaller percentage, and YouTube and solar guitars is obviously a bigger portion income right there. And I mean, before I started solar guitars, you know, I only had like sales for royalties for guitars with Washburn or Randall and YouTube and merch. I could make a living out of that, no problem. But the good thing about solar guitars is that I've become a lot more free to do whatever I want on my YouTube channel. So thanks to solar guitars, I haven't done, you know, any sponsored things at all, which is incredible. I'm free to do whatever I want. And that type of freedom is just making me insanely happy. And I think that shows in my videos, and it shines through that, you know, right now I'm just doing whatever I want. I'm not forced to do anything. And that freedom alone is worth so much to me. But in percentages, I would say now probably 50% solar guitars, maybe 40% YouTube, 10% merch. Right there. Okay? Does that make sense? Thank you. Freezing Jazzy. Hey Ola, not really a question per se, but I saw this today. Isn't the YouTube advertisement system fantastic? It's a Washburn Solar V signed by the Red Hot Chili Peppers. Edit. Bloody hell, that link looks so shady. Okay, let's click this. What the fuck is this? The Red Hot Chili Peppers band signed Washburn Blackened Flying V Oblivion electric guitar. What the fuck is this? That's the Solar logo right there. Holy shit, I have... What the fuck is this? That is a weird looking fucking Washburn headstock right there. That is the Solar headstock, but the Washburn logo... Can I sue? Holy shit, man. And it's also a reversed Solar logo on the fretboard. What? And the body shape is not even a Solar. I don't know what the body shape is. What is that? Looks like shit. This has to be a scam, man. And is it really signed by... You know, I don't think this is... You know, this guitar itself, it's a fucking scam. So I would imagine the band signing it is a scam as well. These are not their real signatures. That's what I imagine. I mean, what the fuck is this guitar, man? I've never seen this body shape, man. But this is the Solar logo backwards and the Solar Washburn headstock. Dude, that's really sketchy. I guess I can't do shit about it. Well, there you go. That's the internet for you right there. D. Marty, hey Ola, have you ever done any reviews of studio monitors? What would you suggest what to look for? Thanks, D. Marty. I never did... Well, did I? Did I make reviews out of these? I think I sort of did. Now, Dinaudio sent me these, and I made a video out of them, but I can't really recall that I commented on trying to demonstrate the monitors other than me saying that I like the sound. Because, you know, I'm not a pro when it comes to studio monitors. In my humble opinion, I think that any studio monitor will work as long as you like the sound. You know, I was mixing with small computer speakers for a very, very long time, and, you know, I knew those computer speakers by heart, so I can use them for mix, basically. So it's more about learning the monitors that you have, but obviously getting a monitor that you like the sound of, I think it's very important, obviously, so you can sit and you don't get tired in your ears. These, the Dinaudio, I like them a lot. The Yamaha I had before, I like them as well. The Behringer I had before the Yamahas, they were also great. So for me, it's like, I'm probably the worst demonstrator when it comes to studio monitors, because I think everything sounds great. Yeah, and I'm also not a pro, I'm not a mixer even. I have no idea what I'm doing when I'm mixing. So there you go. Jeff Majura, Ola England, serious question here. When you play that galloping metal groove, how do you get rid of that scratchy pick attack sound? When I try, there's so many scratchy sounds that it muffles the actual riff. It's Jeff Majura! I love you. Okay, let's go. So you're getting scratchy sounds. The thing about metal galloping is that you have to switch between like a single string galloping and chords, right? Usually you don't gallop the full chord, so... If you gallop the chord, you have to put so much more effort into your picking other than when you just gallop on one string, so... So when you try and incorporate more strings and more sliding, you know, it becomes a little bit more hard to hear what you're playing. It gets more accentuated when you do single strings, you know. But I think it's just about technique. I mean, it's not easy. I think it's more about just starting slow and build your speed with time, basically. I think scratchiness comes from the way you're angling a guitar pick while you're playing. So I think it's more about technique, more than anything else, when you gallop. And a very, very common mistake that I do as well is that when I tense up, I tend to angle the pick even more. So it's almost like this. It's almost vertical compared to the strings. which is fucking weird, I agree. I can only speak for myself because I have a weird picking technique, but if you go the regular way, I can't demonstrate. I can only relate to my own picking technique and... I don't know, Jen. I wish I could help you. Maybe you have to record a video of yourself showing what you're doing, and maybe I can help you out. Just like I did with the Andertons guys. How are those guys doing, by the way? I have no idea. Did they progress? No? Great. Guys, thank you so much for watching. That was FAQ 145 for you right there. If you have any questions, please post them in the comment section of this video, and maybe I'll feature you in the next... I was about to say Sunday with Ola, but it's... Fuck! 145. Stay safe!
Num num.
And be well, my friends, and I'll see you next video, okay? Thank you, bye.